Welcome to our Sunday morning worship service.
Good morning and welcome to First Congregational United Church of Christ, where no matter who you are or where you are in life's journey, you are welcome here. We're delighted that you've joined us this Sunday, whether you're snowed in local or you're someplace warm and you have no idea that there's such a thing as snow this morning because it's nice and bright and sunny outside your house. We're glad that you're joining us for worship today. We have a couple of announcements for you this morning. First, please stay with us after service. For our clergy cafe, we'll talk about worship, sermon, anything under the sun that you'd like to chat about, but we'd love to interact with you following today's worship service. You can find that link on our Facebook or on our website. Also, on Tuesday nights, Church Without Borders, our online Bible study, it begins at 7 o'clock every Tuesday night, again on Facebook Live or on the church website, and also following that, a chance to chat and talk about those Bible texts. We'd love to have you join us. A week from today is our annual meeting for our congregation. Signups are online for that. There is an ability to call in if you do not have a working website or ability to Zoom or things like that. We would be happy to have you join with us just with the audio and be a part of that annual meeting. And I think that is all of our announcements for this Sunday. So a short announcements list, and let us begin our time of worship.
God, as we gather, perhaps not in person, but as two or more in spirit draw near to us,
we ask you to speak to that which in us, which keeps us distanced from you and from authentic life and discipleship. Draw us out of the disquiet of our souls. Speak to the emptiness, the void, to the places that feel shallow or hollow or empty.
Speak to the secrets or the shames and regrets that paralyze us from believing you would treasure us. Speak to the hidden shadows of temptation and greed that consume our thoughts or our generosity and consume our concern for our brother or sister that we cling to so tightly.
Speak that these barriers might be drawn out of us, that they would hold sway over us no more. Still speaking, God, speak new life into us, new beginnings, new hope, new possibilities. Meet us as you met the surprised crowd that day at the synagogue, those church-going folks breaking their routines that they might receive something more. Amen.
Of
worship continues as we continue to hear from this first chapter in the Gospel of Mark. We have the 21st through the 28th verses today. They went to Capernaum, and it was the Sabbath, and Jesus went to the synagogue and began to teach. The people were amazed at his teaching, because he taught them as one who had authority, not as the teachers of the law. Just then, a man in their synagogue who was possessed by an impure spirit cried out, "What do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, Holy One of God." "Be quiet," said Jesus sternly. "Come out of him." The impure spirit shook the man violently and came out of him with a shriek. The people were all so amazed, and they asked each other, "What is this? A new teaching and with authority? He even gives orders to the impure spirits, and they obey him." News about him spread quickly over the whole region of Galilee. Here ends this portion of the text we have been given for today. May we be blessed, if not perplexed, in our hearing, and then blessed in understanding when we hear the word expounded upon in a bit.
See him on the TV preaching about the promised land. Tells me believing Jesus steals some money from my hands. Some say he was a good man. Lord, I think he sinned. It's 22 years of mental tears, cried suicide of the I'm been for losing one of four, sure his country didn't want him back. The bullets took his best friend in Saigon, the lawyers took his wife, his kids, no regrets. In a time I don't remember, in a war he can't forget. God, forgive me for what I've done there, cause I never meant the things I did. Give me something to believe in. If there's a Lord above, give me something to believe in. Oh, Lord, arise. My best friend died a lonely man. Some palm screens, a hotel room. I got the call last Christmas Eve and they told me. Tried all night not to break down and cry as the tears rolled down my face. Felt so cold and empty, like a lost soul out of place. And the mirror, mirror on the wall sees my smiling face again. Give me something to believe in. Something to believe in. Something oh, to believe in. Sometimes I wish to God I didn't know now the things I didn't know then. I drive by the homeless sleeping on a cold dark street, like bodies in an open grave. Underneath the broken old neon sign, used to read Jesus Saves. My way live the rich folks, and I see how they're living it up. While the poor they eat from hand to mouth, the rich drink from the golden cup. And it makes me wonder why so many lose and so few win. Give me something to believe in.
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 Give me something to believe in. Times I wish to God I didn't know now the things I didn't know then. And give me something to believe in.
I want to thank our guest musicians today, and also wish Kelly and Maria well, as they've been out ill. Let us pray. God, there is a struggle at some point in time within each of our lives, whether individually or with those we love, we see ourselves just barely able to tread water in life with things that trouble us, things that hold us, whether they're guilt or doubt, past regrets or shame, some form of sin or addiction that we watch as it just destroys the person we know. In polite company and talk, even on Sunday mornings, we don't talk about things beyond the surface very much, things that eat away at a life, things that change the people we know and sometimes change us, not for the better. Our brothers and sisters of the past in the first century talked about this in ways that spoke of demons. It's how they talked about evil. We don't know what to do with those kind of texts sometimes, God, so we sometimes just avoid it and don't talk about it at all. Help us in the places we hide, in the places we're discomforted and disquieted, in the places we just as soon not touch at all. Because to go there would make us pretty vulnerable and pretty disquieted. And frankly, we wouldn't know what to do with something so raw. Meet us in those places this day, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Reverend Richard Volez, some of his sermon on this text I was magnetized to, drawn to, so I'm going to borrow some of his opening and try to fuse it with some of my own, but I want to give him credit. He said, you know, just like we tend to go to church on a Sunday, I know we're not in service right now, but that routine, that habit, it was an ordinary Sabbath. People gathered at the synagogue, started talking, you know, how you been? Some kind of weather we're having. I understood your son was under weather. How is he doing? How's work going? You know, those kind of conversations we chit-chatted up with one another when we gather. And beyond that, social component and seeing people we know, sitting where we normally sit. People are creatures of habit. I don't care if it's first century or 2,000 years later. There were expectations of what the routines of worship, what the expected norms were. The scribe or teacher of law would get up, unroll the Torah, the sacred scrolls, speak the words of Scripture. The people would listen, and then there'd be an engagement. The scribe or teacher of the law later in time, a rabbi would expound, pastors would expound on the text, and people would hope to hear something that we each would draw from and take into our day-to-day lives. There'd be songs or hymns or cantor or psalm, much as we experience in our everyday, predictable, routine, set, comfortable worship. And that's not to say that those things aren't good and build a sense of serenity, of connection, of togetherness, but it can also become such rote, memorized, you know, call to worship happens here, then the hymn, then we, and then eventually the Lord's Prayer, the offering, and it can become so routine, dare I say, that some say so vanilla, so ordinary that it becomes dull, boring, that there might have been teens in that first century synagogue saying, hey, can I have this the bulletin, because not to see, you know, what the text was or what hymns were chosen, but just to doodle, that a spouse might be sitting there counting the lights or the ceiling tiles or maybe the pipes on the organ when things get, I'm just speculating here because I don't know for sure, but maybe the lull of the routine and the predictability could get to such a place that if you were a little tired and it was a little warm in the congregation, maybe you might even nod off to sleep and catch a few winks. Not that that ever happens. Again, not from my own experience. Not that there's ever been choir members snoring behind me. But sometimes we just have this expectation that this is how it is, right? And on that Sunday or that Sabbath, as people were gathered in the synagogue, they expected a lot of the same old, same old. This is worship. Except the stranger gets up and whoever was on the schedule, this guy wasn't on the schedule, whoever was supposed to be speaking, I imagine, was sitting in their seat saying, who is this guy? Jesus gets up there, reads from the scroll, and starts to teach them. And all of a sudden, people are saying, who is this guy? Do you know who this is? And suddenly, he begins to speak to them, not at them, but to them in a way that brings these scriptures to life, meets them right in the wheelhouse of who they are, and with authority, with everyday life power to make this real in the shoes they're standing in. And as he's going to sit down, there's this excitement, this fervor. Is this guy coming back? If he's here every week, I think maybe I could invite some of my friends because this guy's interesting. This guy pulls me in. He has something to say. And just as he's about to sit down, there's another voice from the back of the synagogue. It's somebody they recognize. You know, it's Solomon, their neighbor. But all of a sudden, he's speaking in a very different voice than the one they know him to have. Jesus of Nazareth, what have you to do with us? Have you come here to destroy us? We know who you are. And we see this kind of chilling effect. Everybody in the synagogue just has pin drop silence. This is not an everyday normal worship experience. This is not an everyday Sunday. And everybody's looking around saying, what the heck is going on? And the stranger, Jesus, speaks to this thing, this demon that has power over him. Be silent and come out of him now. The man shakes, convulses, and all of a sudden, he's Solomon again. Now, people were shocked, and there was definitely a buzz going around the worship service that day. And I suspect that many of us, I know my reaction is there another text to preach this Sunday? Because many of us in this kind of postmodern, even post-science in some way world, look at texts that talk about demon possession and say, those first century folks, they just needed to come out of their caves. I mean, with all the advances in science and medicine, the guy was probably ill, maybe he is epileptic, had a seizure, you know, and we explain it away to say, oh, we've had all these advances and it was probably some kind of mental illness or something going on there, and that's something they didn't know about, so that's how they explained it. But to just take that explanation as an easy out, I think kind of lets us off the hook too easily. Because in Mark's gospel, there's 13 different healing stories. 9 of them have no mention of any kind of demonic things going on. So there's something specific that Mark wants to talk about. And as I mentioned in the prayer, it's this evil. How do we talk? How did the first church talk about evil, first century? And I fear, brothers and sisters, that if we disregard it as ancient hocus pocus, then there's suddenly this void where in polite Midwest, we don't talk about evil at all. It's like sitting at the Thanksgiving table or the dinner table, and there's some subjects that we're just not comfortable in our politeness to talk about, or they're just not in our wheelhouse, right? So for some of us, that might be sports because we're not into sports. For some of us, that might be politics. For some of us, that might be hot button topics like abortion or racial injustice or climate change or whatever it may be, and we just politely have nothing to say. But these texts are part of our scripture. And in Mark's gospel, the exorcism of people, the casting out of demons, is one of the defining aspects of Jesus' ministry. He mentions it 4 different times, chapters 1, 5, 7, and 9. And in each case, there's something that Jesus is calling out of these folks in order to restore them to something full and healing with God. Now, it might be difficult for us. It's difficult for me sometimes because in our tradition, the idea of exorcism, I mean, maybe you think of, you know, the movie The Exorcist and the Bible burning and the guy's hands and the little girl, you know, with her head spinning and vomiting green spew and all that kind of stuff. But in other sections of the church, there are exorcism priests and clergy who are asked to cast out demons in a specialized way. So I know that a lot of us struggle with this kind of idea of external evil. What about the things that disrupt us so much? The addictions that people have. He's got a lot of demons he's fighting. The way that sometimes in our own self-assurance and possessions, our possessions possess us. And I don't mean in a kind of Damien kind of way. I mean that we get so self-secured and reliant in all of our stuff that really the idea of the security that our dollars and cents have provided, that we've told us ourselves that we have built a life for ourselves, we've earned it, and then suddenly we realize just how little control any of our material things bring us. With a tough diagnosis, a near accident that was nearly fatal, something that happens to a loved one, and we feel the weight of powerlessness and smallness. John Ortberg writes in his book, When the Game is Over, It All Goes Back in a Box, about this six-figured, high-powered executive who spent so much of his life earning that corner office, getting the corporate car and flying in first class and getting all this stuff to provide for his family, working late into the night at his keyboard till 2 or 3 in the morning to get ahead, but all the hours he missed with his children, his family, his wife or spouse going to bed hours before, how many intimate closenesses he had passed on just to build up this version of himself. And then Ortberg writes, in this clarity, he has a heart attack there at the keyboard. And in 10 to 30 seconds of realization, as his heart is blocked, he's small capillaries he's never even thought about. And he realizes the foolishness that he's waited so much on the stuff and so little on the people in his life. And now it's over. There's a lot of things, and I guess I would ask each of us, what would it be that Christ, if God was speaking to us, would say, come out of us, draw out of us in a way that is something that holds us or keeps us from this fullness of relationship with God? If Jesus is speaking with authority or power and a way that relates God to us, the question must be in some way, what is our relationship with God like? Are we just treading water? Are we just on the surface, just kind of floating about? Or are we willing to be vulnerable and go into the depths a little bit? And I think he would challenge it in the same way with church. Is it just the routine and predictability? Is it country club-esque where we fit in and we belong and membership has its privileges? Or is it something that really gets at the nitty-gritty, all of who we are, even the places we don't like to talk about or admit are part of who we are, and let God have that too? Annie Dillard, in her book, Teaching a Stone to Talk, says, does anyone have the foggiest idea what kind of power we so blithely invoke? I suspect that no one really believes a word of it when we speak it on Sunday. The churches are children, her words not mine, playing on the floor with their chemistry sets, mixing up a batch of TNT to kill a Sunday morning. It is madness, she writes, for ladies to wear straw hats and velvet gloves to church. We should all be wearing crash helmets. Ushers should issue life preservers and signal flares, and they should lash us to our pews. For the sleeping God just may wake up someday and take offense at our banal worship, or the waking God might just wake up and draw us to a place we've never been before and cannot return to because we've been changed by the experience. We do a good job, if we're honest, and I know this isn't going to be a popular word, but we do a good job of keeping Jesus at arm's length, at polite distance. If we can just domesticate and routine it enough, the idea that something transformative, something gut-wrenching, something that breaks within us, something that opens up within us, might happen during worship, whether in this space, in an hour on Sunday, or in our day-to-day living as we worship, because worship doesn't just happen in this space, right? A doxology is not just a song we sing. It's a way we glorify God in that everything we do, whether making lunch with the kids or going to the library with the family or going to work or sitting in the office, can have a form of glorifying to God in that space, in that moment, wherever we are. And so this idea that Jesus has come to speak out all those things which hinder us, which stifle us, which bore us or subtle us into a faith that is just, well, it really honestly doesn't have much meaning to us. And says, I want to give you something fuller. I want to draw out those things that prevent you. And in our day and age, back in the first century, Mark's not writing about, virtual reality shows or cloning or stem cell research or any of the things that modern society is dealing with. But I've mentioned this before, sometimes maybe evil is not, little horn figures with a pitchfork and flames, but it's that subtle exchange of what could be an amazing life for something that is even a virtual life never lived. It's, replacing the real with something that's imaginary. And that's not to say that we don't enjoy some things or hobbies or binge watch shows or things like that that give us reprieve from the day-to-day harshness of life, but it's to say that there is a danger, a subtlety of not living the life we're given. And in this moment in this synagogue, Jesus is calling the people there and us to experience God in everyday experiences, in a heart that's grateful, that's changed, that's reshaped again and again, and called for something more. Abundant living. A new way of being. That's why the early church called it the way, not a faith, not a religion, but the way of being with God that influenced every other aspect of what they were doing and who they were as people. Now, as they sat there that synagogue morning, that day that they worshiped, they weren't expecting any of it as it was. And I wonder for you and I today, as we wrestle with who we are and who we are called to be, and those places where we just kind of avoid being, what it might mean for Christ to stand and speak out of us those things that keep us from a fuller relationship with God and with each other. What are those things that need to be brought out and named in our life and seen and reshaped and transformed by the power of God? It could be long-held grudges or anger that have changed who we are or how we see one another in the world. This vindictive kind of judgment where we sit on the courtroom of God's throne and not God. It could be a host of things. Self-doubts, self-loathing, being told again and again that we're not good enough, and then believing that because of what everybody else has told us about ourselves, despite those baptism promises that we are beloved of God, we have come to believe that we're not worth anything. And all of our failures and past regrets have us paralyzed into believing that God could do anything with me now because I can't forgive myself. These are the places Jesus has come to speak out to. And these are, my brothers and sisters, the places where good, polite, respectable, predictable worship we avoid talking about all too often. Because it might rock the boat. It might make us squirm in the seats a little bit. It might create a disquiet in our soul. And God just might show up. And the idea that God would have all of me scares the heck out of me. I'm speaking out of me. How about you? You say, well, Pastor, you're a preacher. How can you say that? Yes, the idea that God would have every part of who I am, even the parts I hold on to tightly. What would God say to every aspect of who I am? Because there are places I don't know if I'm ready to hear yet. There are places where I'm afraid, what would God say? What would God ask me to give up? What would God ask me to let go of? I love what Dillard says. God just might show up and shake us up. And in one sense, how grand and glorious that would be. And on the other hand, how intimidating and a little bit frightening. Because we have no clue what all Jesus might have to say to us. But it is that openness, that vulnerability, and God who is still speaking. Because in doing so, God changes who we are, brings out light in who we are, and calls out those shadow selves, those places of darkness, and says, those things are not going to hold you as my children anymore. come walk with me in the light. Be transformed. Be new creations. So how about it, my brothers and sisters? I know we have an annual meeting like we do every year next week. Wouldn't it be something? Is as we're thinking about the things for the new year as a church, we thought anew, each one of us and all of us together, what would it mean for God to speak within us something new? Speak to those places we haven't allowed God to speak yet and really had us, opened us, and called us into a new chapter again. What an adventure that might be. Do you have your crash helmet? Because this is no ordinary Sunday. Amen.
As we move into this time of offering, I bring a small point after such a wonderful sermon. And that is that Jesus was teaching in the synagogue, and while people were amazed, this impure or unclean spirit, whatever, it cried out. It got all noisy and in the face of the holy and the sacred. And while I acknowledge there's this great time for praise and for being loud and abundant joy, I wonder if today we're trying to shout above the noise of the day, the impurities, the pollutants, everything that blocks our view and our hearing. We're so busy doing that that we aren't really paying tons of attention. So if we could offer, just offer time this week to try and listen, to offer silence. And to remember that the church, this church, is called the body of Christ for a reason. Because we're united in a way that we're supposed to listen and then take what's offered from our listening. We're united so that as the body of Christ, we can offer healing and hope to those that are turned away. We can offer to listen to those who have been wounded, to understand, and then to offer that new way that comes through God alone. Because here in the church, we understand that while offering those things might be in our hands, what happens is completely out of our control. So we can place our trust wholly in God alone, now and forevermore. Amen.
Every time I try to make it on my own, every time I try to stand, I start to fall. And all those lonely roads that I've traveled on, there was Jesus. The life I built came crashing to the ground. When the friends I had were nowhere to be found, I couldn't see it then, but I can see it now. There was Jesus. Forgiveness and a price I didn't pay. I'm not perfect, so I thank God every day. There was Jesus. Searching and the healing, the hurt, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it, couldn't see it. There was Jesus on the mountains, in the valleys. Shadows of the alleys.
There was Jesus
in the fire, in the flood.
There was Jesus.
Always is and always was. Oh, oh, oh. No, I never walk alone.
Never.
You're always there. Searching the healing in the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it, couldn't see it. There was Jesus. There.
If your spirit is willing, I invite you to join me in prayer. Sovereign God, who creates and recreates, a way for hope and paves a path for peace, forgiving all, giving all, and blessing all, we give you thanks. And pray that you will open a way for us and a way for hope to grow. We pray. We pray to you, Lord of our past and of the present, for those who are giving care and those who are in need of healing, for those who are walking in dark places, and those who are grieving and know the power of sorrow. Whether the grief is death of a loved one or of hope, the death of a dream or a job or an envisioned future, Lord, we pray. We pray for those who are facing a surgery or hospitalization in the coming weeks. We pray for those who staff our hospitals and those who teach our children. Lord, we pray, knowing that it's not only teachers who teach our children, but it's every one of us. Lord, we pray. We pray that you will give to all of us a renewed hope, that you will grant that we will see that it is growing and living within us, and release that spirit that you have planted within us, that we will walk within the way that you pray for us. For you are the Lord of this moment, each moment, quenching the dryness of our soul and calling forth a birth and rebirth that can be made visible. Lord, we pray. We pray, for we are your people, and each breath we utter can be prayer to you. Prayer spoken, prayer lived, and prayer known in silence. As individuals, we are united in one family through the prayer that you shared in your Son, who said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
I've had good days, I've had bad days, tasted victory and defeat. I've had problems, big as planets, turn to pebbles when you speak. I've had nothing to my name, never lacked for anything. 'Cause you were there with me.
You've been my savior, sustainer when I'm at my end. My healer, redeemer again and again. My mother,
when I stand before you guilty, oh, your mercy bears my name. When in pride I think I'm worthy, you point out the price you paid. When I wander far away, you keep calling out my name. 'Cause you give up on me.
I was on a youth mission trip. It was more of a spiritual retreat at Wilderness Trail out in Virginia. They had us each, they said we were going up for a worship experience up to the top of this mountain. They had us each take these rocks, you know, pretty good size little stones, and hike them up the mountain about a mile to the worship site. And we got there, and much as Bill had those slides in the last song of this mountaintop kind of cross, there's a big 15-foot, 20-foot cross, and during communion, we all had these stones we had lugged up there, and I said, you know what? I want you to think about those things that you carry. And Jesus is saying, just will you put that down? You don't have to carry this weight anymore. And before we took communion, they invited us to bring these stones and put them at the foot of this cross. And what we realized were there were hundreds of these things that others had already brought. And it was a very powerful experience, this idea of, you know, Jesus saying, just will you let me have you? Will you just put it down, please? You don't have to carry that baggage anymore. A lot of us are weighed down by stuff. Whatever you want to name it, that Christ says, get out of my child and come walk with me. May the power of the living God in worship, that's not just an hour on Sunday, but every day, who we are, be with you in faith, in hope, and in love right now and throughout this day and beyond. Go in peace, my brothers and sisters. Amen.
Have you ever met those who keep humming when the song's through? It's like they're living life to a whole different tune. And have you ever met those that keep hoping when it's hopeless? It's like they figured out what the rest haven't yet. The second you realize what you ever thought, it's only just a matter of just want to dance. You don't have to know how to. Ever since Grace got you left, so your whole side's hurt and smile, like you just got away with something. Why? Cause you just got away with something. Ever since Grace got you. So when you're standing in the rain again, you might as well be dancing. Ever since Grace got you.
Yeah.
Grace got you.